Well, hello there, and welcome to The Pulse, your one-stop shop for everything St. Charles. My name is Ryan Cooper, and I'm very honored today to be talking with my buddy Ed Akers about all things magical on Main Street.
With the CVB, which is the Convention and Visitors Bureau.
All those words.
And an ampersand. Tell me what you guys do. It's like you are the city, but you're this different, cool, kind of special part of the city.
We are. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, don't tell the other departments that, but for the average person on Main Street, they know the tourism center is having the best restrooms on the street. So right. we get a lot of that.
I didn't know that.
But aside from being the best public restrooms, we are exactly what you would expect a tourism center to be. We are a group of people who are dedicated to getting people here to experience everything there is about St. Charles. We all love it here. And so you have a part of the tourism center that's all about sales. So they're reaching out to different conventions and people who have meetings, trying to get them to come here to St. Charles. Mm-hmm. And if they're having their convention or their meeting here, they're eating here, they're staying here in our hotels. So that's good for us. But then you have our content creators who are writing blogs and they're covering social media in a fun way to get people to see what there is to enjoy here. And then you have me, who as the special events producer, I kind of tackle all the big type of events that have to do with actors, performers, or history. So I obviously, my main focus is on our big holiday festivals. We have Legends and Lanterns, our annual Halloween festival, St. Charles Christmas Traditions, our big one. And then last year we started Once Upon a Valentine, which is all about Valentine's Day. But then I also kind of oversee a walking tour program called Hit the Bricks. So it's a lot going on, but it's just different ways for people to engage with the city, whether they're local or mostly in what we do, whether they're from far away.
A lot of other cities probably don't have someone in charge of actors. Like when you say that, you know, I get it. I've lived here for a long time. But I imagine if you said this in another city or another city, especially the size of St. Charles, they'd be like, what do you mean you're in charge of the actors?
Yeah, it is a very good point. And what makes our events special is that they are immersive events. And part of that immersive nature is you need to have great storytellers. So for instance, for our festivals, we have people who are portraying famous figures of history, literature, and folklore. And exactly as you said, any other city you go to, and they're going to be like, what are you talking about? And it's something that I've said many times, that we are very lucky in St. Charles to have people who are willing to take what some would say a risk of having something that is so actor-centric, performing-centric. Here, they are all about, you know, not only embracing the past, but looking towards the future and seeing what we do and what we do well and putting together the people who excel at what they do, performers especially, and saying, you know what, that is important to the identity and the DNA of the city. And over the years, I've been involved with the Christmas Festival this will be my 19th season coming up. And just to see how the city has embraced Christmas traditions and allowed it to grow is not only a great feather in the cap of the city, but it's great for the visitors too.
And I think as a longtime resident and someone who has experienced Christmas traditions, the last thing I think of, which is a testament to you and your team, is that these people are actors.
Yes.
Right? I don't think that the city just went out and hired a bunch of actors. I think I'm in Christmas land from all these different places.
Yeah.
And the other interesting thing I think you said was that it was a risk. And I guess it is, but I mean, being down here doesn't seem like a risk, right? Because this thing goes off without a hitch, and this is the 50th anniversary.
Yes.
And I don't know about the first year or the second year, but as long as I've been here, and seemingly as long as you've been here, it doesn't seem like a risk, right? I mean, it just happens, and it's fantastic.
Right, and that's one of those things that we always say. I mean, we start planning next year's event like a week after our current season ends. And we always say that we're doing our jobs right if it seems like we just walk in one day, flip a switch, and you know, Main Street goes from being regular Main Street to in its full Christmas regalia.
And that's what it feels like.
Yeah, but you know, it takes a lot of people. It's not just me, it's everyone at the Convention and Visitors Bureau. It's every one of our 96 actors and crew members that we all need to be in lockstep on the same page and dedicate complicated as well, because you have to think these are people who are giving up, you know, time with their friends and their families at the most wonderful time of the year for the sole purpose of making visitors and residents of St. Charles smile. And, you know, that can weigh on you emotionally, but we have the right people who are here. They are dedicated to that. And if you didn't have that, if you had people who are just going through the motions, you don't have what we have that makes it so special. You don't have the people that make you feel like, oh, I'm talking to Ebenezer Scrooge. Mm. You just have people in costumes, and that's not the same. The stories we hear, I mean, it breaks your heart and fills you with pride at the same time. You know, you have people who write to us and say, you know, my daughter was being bullied at school. She felt like she had no friends, and she came here, and your characters were her friend, and they loved her, and they treated her, you know, just the way she was, that she was special as she was. And, you know, we had this older couple this year who they were waiting in line to meet Santa, and the gentleman was terminally ill, and this was going to be his last Christmas, and he said he had to come to Christmas traditions because that's where they had their first date many years ago, and they once took a picture kissing in front of Santa as he was covering his eyes, and they said, we had to get one more picture like that. And, you know, you hear stories like that, and you realize that, you know, to some people who come to this, they say, oh, you know, those cute little holiday events they do in St. Charles isn't that charming. But for some people, this means a lot, and to a lot of people, and we never take that for granted.
Tell me how you got here. Like, did you go to school? Do you go to school for a thing like this? How does this kind of unfold?
That is a great question. I think it is a great mixing bowl of just a whole bunch of experiences I had. I first got involved with Christmas traditions when I was a junior in high school. I had just done a production of Fiddler on the Roof with some people who were running the festival at that time. So they said, hey, we run this Christmas thing. We think you'd be a good match for it. And that was really one of my earliest times ever being on Main Street.
Were you playing a character then?
I was. Okay. I was good old Jack Frost, as I still am.
That's
19
right.
Okay. years later. but that's how I got started. And I really fell in love with the area, never intending that 19 consecutive years later, I would still be here. But during all that time, you know, I went to Fontbonne University, may it rest in peace.
Really? I know. That's wild.
Yeah, so I went there. I was a theater major there, okay. But I was also very interested in history. So I was a tour guide many different places, you know, the St. Louis Holocaust Museum and with Busch Stadium. And I gave tours of Washington, D.C. for groups. So it was sort of like what we do here in St. Charles kind of mixed everything I loved. It mixed history, it mixed performing. You throw my Disney lifestyle when I was a performer down there, then they closed my show. So I said, oh no, because that's showbiz. So sometimes they close your show. And I had to come back to St. Louis. And that's when I said, you know, I'm going to take everything I've learned in all these aspects of my life and created Legends and Lanterns in 2016. We're almost celebrating 10 years
Look
of
at that.
It's, yeah. It's wild how time flies. But yeah, it was, you know, the Convention and Visitors Bureau and Elizabeth Phelps, who's been with me from the very beginning. She's the assistant director of the Tourism Center. She's a very artsy person herself.
Sure.
And she has that vision. And she said, you have a lot of talents that I think that we can harness in a non-traditional way for a city and, you know, use your special skills, use the city's resources and kind of blend them into something that is uniquely St. Charles.
Yeah. You know, it's come up on this podcast before that St. Charles feels like a place where you are free to kind of share an idea and create and kind of people will let you run with that. Whether it's from a creative standpoint or just a visionary or an idea standpoint, can kind of have this space to create this and this opportunity. And I think that's amazing.
It's true. And having the wherewithal as a city from the top down to hire great people who know what they're doing and trust them to do their thing.
Yeah.
You can say, hey, Ryan Cooper, you know, theater and history, you kind of know that thing. Do it.
Yeah.
Letting the people do what they do well.
Yeah. All right, now we've talked about Christmas traditions, Legends and Lanterns, and you said a quarter of a million people each year for those two events.
Right.
I am not familiar, I'm sorry to say, with the Valentine's event. Can you talk about that?
It's brand new. Yeah. It's what we call a micro festival. Okay. So you have Legends and Lanterns and Christmas traditions that take place over multiple weekends. But we have such a great cast, and we've always said, you know, what is something that we can do in the winter months where people are cold, they're staying inside, they're not... You know, the foot traffic on Main Street isn't as heavy as it is in the fall and during Christmas time. So we were thinking, what is something we can do to drive people out here? And the idea was Valentine's Day. So our little micro festival, it takes place literally on a single weekend over, you know, 3 hours each. And of course it was us. So we said, you know, we can't just do a plain Jane, you know, Valentine's event. What is something that's going to make it unique to us? And so we have an event that we created that is half pro-Valentine's and half anti-Valentine's.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
So,
for everyone.
So you have characters like Romeo and Juliet and Cupid who are there. But then we also have anti-Valentine's characters like St. Valentine's Day Massacre gangsters or the Six Wives of Henry VIII who have a very, you know, rocky relationship with romance. So, and every character you meet has a different activity that goes along with them.
So obviously notorious for playing Jack Frost. Mm-hmm. Do you play something in Legends and Lanterns? Do you take on a character or persona?
No, for Legends and Lanterns, I'm just proud to be the happy father watching it, watching it all happen. But you will certainly see me, you know, going around in my very neon colored vest, making sure that everything's running smoothly. I foresee that, you know, Jack is a part of me, so I will always be there for him. But I think for any events that come down the pipeline, I'm happy to, you know, after many years as a performer, kind of take the directing seat and just kind of observe, because then that way you get to see people enjoying what you're producing as well.
It's the 50th anniversary or the 50th year for Christmas traditions. Yeah. Anything up your sleeve, like anything different that's going to be planned or
happening?
We've got a lot of
things going on. So we'll have a documentary that will kind of cover not only the history, but also give you a peek behind the scenes. We have all kinds of special events within the season. The Foundry Arts Center is doing a special exhibit. We're going to have special tree lighting ceremonies. We're going to have a time capsule we're going to bury that will be opened on opening day of Christmas Traditions 100th anniversary season.
Wow.
And then we've got some new characters we're excited to introduce. So we've got lots of things up our sleeves, but it's still going to be the familiar Christmas traditions that you know and love. We're not, you know, doing something that will make it unrecognizable, but it's definitely going to feel special this year.
I love it, man. I love living in St. Charles, and part of the reason is these festivals and events that happen. So I appreciate that. Sincerely.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Talk about Hit the Bricks.
Yeah, so Hit the Bricks.
What is that
the
called?
Viewmaster. Absolutely. So
that's
the thing that people see us with those on the street all the time. They're like, I had one of those as a kid.
Yeah.
But it kind of sparked from an idea I had. I used to go on walking tours with people sometimes, and they'd have like binders full of like crinkled laminated pictures. And they're like, this is what this building used to look like. And I'm like, we can do better than that. So I said, well, why not get Viewmasters with custom slides made of the street? And so that way, as you're taking this historical walking tour, you can hold it up and you can see what the buildings you're talking about looked like back in the day. So you can
really
see how much they've changed, or in most cases, how much they haven't changed. But then it's also fun because we talk about the Grand Opera House on North Main. Mm-hmm. And the theater upstairs no longer exists, but we have pictures of what that looked like. So you can use your Viewmaster and feel like you're standing in the auditorium. So it's really a fun way, not only to entice people to take the tour, but it's a fun way to engage with history. And since it kind of takes your whole, you know, vision, you kind of feel like you're there at the same time. So that's fun. But currently we offer two different tours that essentially split the historic district in half. And it's $7. It's an hour-long tour. You get a great guide. And you get to play with a Viewmaster. And now every tour you go on will give you a set of 5 free souvenir postcards that all have historical images of St. Charles. So if you go on both tours, you're going to walk away with 10 free postcards. And it's pretty neat.
Do you find that the people going on that tour are more residents, more visitors? Is it a split?
It's really a split, which I'm fascinated by. We were thinking it was going to be more visitors, but now you have people who are like, I've lived here all my life, and the things that you learn on this tour make you completely see your hometown in a completely different light, which we appreciate being able to do that for people. And then for people who are just here for an hour looking for something to do, they may have heard of the Lewis and Clark connection with the city, but then they walk away learning that we are so much more than that, you know, few days in 1804. And then they go back to their hometowns and they say, you know, we had a great time in St. Louis, but then we spent some time in St. Charles and it was incredible. You have to get out there.
I love it.
And hence the tourism center. It's all about what we do.
It all comes full circle.
Yeah.
I want to know you a little bit more. Tell me about, so you go to Fontbonne to work at Disney. You moved to Florida right after school, or how did that work?
Yeah, I did. So while I was just out of Fontbonne, I was actually working at the Disney store at the Galleria.
Okay.
But I was doing lots of performing in lots of theaters around town. And I had someone sent an audition to me for the world-famous Hoop-Dee-Doo musical review at Walt Disney World. I went down there on a whim just to audition for it. I was the only person out of town who auditioned for it.
Wow.
And then I didn't hear anything for weeks, and they called me and said, hey, we want to hire you full-time to be in this show to sing about fried chicken and ribs three times a night. And I said, great. And they said, and you have to be down here in 15 days. So I packed up my whole existence. I moved down there 2 weeks later and did that show. It was great. Then I moved on to a clown show in New Fantasyland, where we were essentially the clowns from Dumbo slipping on banana peels and slapping each other upside the head.
Yeah, that's good. It's a good bit.
But I got to learn from actual ringling clowns, which was really fun and a fun thing to put on the resume and
you know,
slip on things at parties.
What's a place that you like to visit? What's your favorite place to go or thing to do in St. Charles? Let's exclude your events that you put on, because that would be easy to say. But is there a favorite restaurant or
So I have the world's biggest sweet tooth.
Okay.
I am 50% sugar, and ice cream is like my favorite food group.
Ooh.
And I know this is going to sound like a cop-out answer, but our three main ice cream places on Main Street I love for different reasons. So you have Riverside that has my favorite flavor, which is ripe raspberry chocolate chunk, and they have very generous portion sizes.
And Riverside is kind of the traditional, like the other places are newer, and they're I like them too, but yeah, that kind of seems like the traditional go-to.
That's good, but I also like funky. So as you can tell, I like funky. So Sugarbot has the funkiest flavors. So I go to them when I'm looking for something new. So I go to them. But then Kilwin's has my favorite staff. They are the smiliest, happiest people. There's one guy who works for them that's singing and dancing all the time.
Yeah.
So if you ever need to pick me up from a staff member, you go to Kilwin's.
That's a very bureaucratic answer.
It is, but the honest truth, I tell you, I'm not blowing smoke there. It depends on my mood, but ice cream is my thing, and we're very fortunate here on Main Street.
Yes, we've talked about the CVB. How do you find this place? Where is it?
Well, for people who want to party with us in person, we are on Main Street
and
in the heart
of
it all. And use the restrooms, absolutely the best ones on the street. They can find us on Main Street at 230 South Main. So we're right across from the big Christmas tree. It's always a Christmas tree year round.
That's right.
To me. 230 South Main Street. Or if people want to kind of catch up with what we do from the comfort of their living rooms, we do have a website that's discoverstcharles.com. It's an awesome website, lots of great videos and photos and information about all that we do. So that's where they can find us.
Ryan Cooper, thanks so much, man. This was fun.
Such a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Thanks for joining us on this episode of The Pulse. Be sure to subscribe on YouTube, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. New episodes come out on the second and fourth Tuesday of each month. Want more content from the city? Be sure to follow and subscribe to our social media channels. That way, you'll be the first to know when we drop new episodes, exclusive interviews, and exciting local stories. For the latest news, events, and city council updates, keep an eye out for the Pulse Check. I'm Ed Akers, and I'll see you in the city.